Hello and welcome. In this video, we are going to talk a bit about integration with complex functions. You will learn how to parameterize the most standard paths. And then you will also learn how to determine when the path is important and when it's not when doing these kinds of calculations. And we will also do a bunch of examples so you really get the hang of it. So, let's get going. If a function is continuous on a directed smooth curve gamma, and note here that a smooth curve is simply a curve that do not cross itself and have no sharp corners. And if now we are able to find some parametrization of gamma, then we know that the integral of a function f along the curve gamma is equal to the following. And in this expression we have that c of t is our parametrization of a curve gamma, and a and b are the constants for the starting and end point of our variable t. The next thing I would like to touch on is, why is the path gamma so important? Why do we need to know how we go from one point to another? In the good old days, when we only needed one axis to describe our input variables, we knew that the only way to go from one point to another was in a straight line. But here in complex analysis, we need two axes to describe our input variables. This means that we are no longer limited to only one path. I could, for example, follow this path here, but it's also completely fine to follow this path, since the only criteria I have is that I go from the starting point to the end point, which I can do in an infinite amount of ways. And this is why it's important to know what kind of path you're taking from the starting point to the end point, since different paths in general gives different answers. Another good thing to know is some standard parametrizations. So, if you, for example, would like to parametrize the straight line that goes from C1 to C2, then we have that the parametrization is going to be equal to the starting point, C1, plus t times the end point minus the starting point. And then the t value will go from 0 to 1, which means that if we insert t is equal to 0, you get the starting point. And if you insert t is equal to 1, you get the end point. And the reason we do this is to preserve a direction of a curve. And in general, when doing these kinds of parametrizations, you always want to have that the lower bound of t inserted into the function gives you the starting point, and that the upper bound of t inserted into the function gives you the end point. This way you will always be able to preserve a direction of curve. So, if instead the path is a circle, then we have that the parametrization is going to be equal to c0, which simply is the center of the circle, plus r, which is the radius, times e raised to the power of I times t. And in this case we will have that t is going from 0 to 2 pi, since we would like to go a complete lap around the circle. But let's say, for example, that you only would like to go half a lap around the circle. Then we will need to change our upper bound limit for t to pi instead of 2 pi. And some other good things to know is that if we would like to determine the integral of a function f plus a function g over some path gamma, then we can just split them up and determine the integrals for f and g separately. And another good quality of life trick is that if your path is made up of two separate paths, then we know that an integral along the bigger path is equal to the sum of integrals along the smaller paths. In our next theorem, we will talk a bit about independence of path, since there actually are some functions that doesn't really care which path you take when you integrate them. As long as the starting and endpoints are the same, integration along different paths will always yield the same results. And the theorem tells us that if a function is continuous on a contour gamma, and a contour is simply made up of a number of directed smooth curves, and the function has an antiderivative on gamma, then we know that the integral of f along gamma is going to be equal to the antiderivative evaluated at the endpoint minus the starting point. These are really the best kind of functions in my opinion, since if I would like, for example, to calculate the integral along this path here, then I can just skip the parametrization part completely, since the only thing that really matters are the starting and endpoints. That was all the theory for this time. Let's continue with some examples. So, here I would like us to compute each integral. And to do that, this information from a previous page will come in handy. We always start by parameterize the path, And in the first example, we have that the path is a line, and therefore we should be using this parametrization here. And with c1 as minus I and c2 as 2 plus I, we get the following expression. And note that 2 plus I minus minus I can be rewritten as 2 plus 2i, and the t values are going to span between 0 and 1 for this parametrization. The next thing we're going to need, according to the formula down here, is the derivative of this parametrization with respect to t, which in our case simply is 2 plus 2i. And now we got everything we need to determine the integral. So we start by replacing the c up here with our parametrization. And then we take the end result and multiply this with the derivative of the parametrization. And remember that the limits for the integral, in this case, is simply the upper and lower bound limits for the t value. And if we now just expand this expression, we get the following. And in this second term here, we can see that the factor 4 plus 4i plus 4i minus 4 can be simplified as 8i. Okay, I need some more space. Here we go, perfect. So the rest from here is your standard procedure. Since we are integrating with respect to variable t, the antiderivative for the integrand will become the following. And by now evaluating this expression at the upper and lower limits, we get the following. And this thing can be simplified to 2i plus 2, which will be our final answer. In our next example, we have the same function and the same start and end points, but this time we're going along a different path. This time we're going along this last quarter of a circle, which is centered at I and with radius 2. And this information gives us the following parametrization. And the hard part here is really to determine the values for the upper and lower limits of the t value. The way I think about it is the following. We are starting at minus I, and that is the down point of this circle here. And the down point in any circle will always have the angle 3 pi divided by 2. And then we go to the right point of the same circle, 2 plus I in this case here. And that point will always have the angle 2 pi, or in other words, 0. So if we now derive this parametrization, we get the following. And now we just repeat the steps from the last example. We start by replacing all the c's in the function with our parametrization. And then we take the result and multiply this with the parametrization's derivative. And remember that the integral's new limits are going to be the upper and lower limits for the t value. If we now try to simplify this a bit, we get that the integrand is equal to minus 2 times e raised to the power of it plus 4i times e raised to the power of 2it. And the antiderivative for this new expression is simply the following. And now you might remember from a previous video that a I in the denominator is the same thing as a minus I in the numerator. So let's use that knowledge once more to simplify this first term here. So the last step is to evaluate this expression for the upper and lower bound of t. And if we do just that, we get the following. And here we can note that e raised to the power of I times 3 pi divided by 2 is equal to minus I. And that e raised to the power of I times 3 pi is equal to minus 1. And by using this, we get that this second term here is going to be equal to 2 minus 2. So that simply becomes 0. So all we're gonna end up with is the first term, which simply is equal to 2i plus 2, since e raised to the power of 0 is equal to 1. And now we can see that this is exactly the same answer as we got in the last example. So it seems like the function doesn't really care which path we take, as long as the start and end points are the same. And this is really no coincidence, since this function has an antiderivative everywhere in the complex plane. So the only thing that really matters when doing the calculations are the start and end points. And this is quite useful for our last example here, since I have absolutely no idea how I would even start to parameterize this path here. And I'm therefore really glad that I don't have to do it. Here we can simply continue by determining the antiderivative for the integrand, which is c raised to the power 2 divided by 2, and then just input our start and end points, which will give us the following. And by now expanding our numerators a bit, we get the following. And if we now write these two terms on the same fraction line, we can see that this simply becomes 2i plus 2, which is exactly what we wanted. Here in our last example, we will look into a path that can be divided into two separate paths, gamma 1 and gamma 2. And to solve these kinds of problems, you first have to parameterize each path separately. So we can start with gamma 1. And since this path is just a line from 0 to 1, we will get the following results. And this can be simplified to just t, and the derivative for this parametrization is simply 1. And for our second path, we have that the starting point is 1, and the end point is 2 plus I. And therefore, the parametrization is going to become the following, with the derivative 1 plus I. And now we can use that instead of determining the integral for a bigger path, we can take the sum of the smaller paths, which is quite useful. And note here that we have the conjugate of c in the integrand, and since our parametrization is going to be equal to c, we have to take the conjugate of our parametrization before we insert it. And the conjugate of our first parametrization in gamma 1 is simply going to be equal to t. But in the case of gamma 2, our parametrization's conjugate is going to be equal to 1 plus t times 1 minus I. So, if we now just insert this information into our formula, we get that the two integrals are going to be equal to the following. And now we can see that the first integral gives us the antiderivative t raised to the power 2 divided by 2, while the second integral gives us the antiderivative t raised to the power 2 divided by 2 times 1 minus I times 1 plus I. And if we now insert our upper and lower limits, we get the following. And this can be simplified by factoring out a half, which will give us the following. And here we can see that this thing here is going to be equal to 2. Which means that the end result is going to be 3 divided by 2. The last thing I would like to touch on is when you integrate this function here, 1 divided by c, you have two options, and you have to look at the path to know which option you are able to take. If the path crosses the negative part of a real axis, or the point 0, then you have to do it the standard way. But if your path is able to avoid this red part of the axis, then you're able to use the antiderivative right away. And this comes from the fact that the principal logarithm is no longer differentiable for inputs along the negative part of a real axis. The function really doesn't know how to handle these kinds of numbers. And we can see that by studying the definition of a function. Here we can see that the function doesn't really know how to handle numbers that have the argument minus pi, which means that it is not defined for these kinds of numbers, which are the numbers on a negative real axis, which implies that it cannot be differentiable for these numbers, since it's not even defined for these numbers. And in a more formal way, we can say that the principal logarithm is not differentiable for c values such that the input function g here lies in the set of the c values on this red line, the negative part of a real axis. And the c values on this line are going to have a x value between minus infinity and up to 0, and the y value has to be 0, which implies that this set also includes the point 0. Thanks for watching.